So obviously America has got a gigantic long-standing problem with mass shootings, and in particular mass shootings at schools. And we are doing absolutely nothing as a country to do really anything about it. But that doesn't mean that the government isn't trying to seem like they're getting involved. And we are lucky now to be joined by Ken Klippenstein, a reporter, investigative reporter for TYT Investigates, who's done some work on the latest move, the latest program by the DHS. Welcome to the show, Ken.
Hey, John, thanks for having me.
Glad to have you on. So you've been doing some digging around. What has the DHS been up to?
Well, they're going to train school children in how to respond to, quote, mass casualty events and how to literally staunch the bleeding that's happening when kids are shot. And so this is supposed to be a program, a multi-million dollar program for high school students. And their hope is to introduce this into curriculum in the same way that students take driver's ed and home ec and just very basic stuff. So very normal thing for the country. And now, this is something that kids are going to have to look forward to.
Obviously, so this seems crazy on the face, especially because it exists in a context where the federal government, most state governments have apparently decided that they're going to do nothing to limit the likelihood that a mass shooting happens. They seem to every program I see, the funding I see, all goes to, okay, it's happened. The shooting has gone on. Here's how we respond. Here's a new thing we give to the police. Here's a bucket of rocks we give to the teachers. But devil's advocate, I guess, optics aside, how likely is this sort of program to actually help in practice? If a mass shooting happens, do we want to be relying on kids to be performing sort of emergency first aid?
I don't think there's any problem with teaching kids first aid, but when you have a very, high pressure situation, and you have children whose brains aren't fully developed, I don't think it's to criticize any criticism of them to say that they're not going to respond in the same way that highly trained EMTs and professionals and frankly adults who are finished developing are going to. So I don't know. It just seems like a lot of pressure to put on a kid. I mean, I felt like I had enough to deal with tests and things. I couldn't imagine. Seeing my friends bleeding out and having to stop that, I wouldn't be surprised if, these poor kids just wouldn't be able to, do it given the pressure in the situation.
Yeah, I mean, the incredible amount of fear that they must be experiencing. Not only that, but obviously if you're in a school right now, if you're in high school, you have lived through any number of high profile mass shootings. The second you hear that noise, the first shot, the wave of fear and anxiety that must pour over you because you've already put yourself mentally there in these past cases. But in your research of this program, it appeared that the DHS does not specifically cite that this is to do with mass shootings. It's just mass casualty events. Are they trying to create some ambiguity about whether this is about more traditional terror attacks or something like that?
No, I think if you read on, there are a lot of context clues, and I don't have the document in front of me to suggest that this is related to the epidemic of shootings. And of course, this grant comes after Sandy or after the Florida shooting, which it's kind of a subjective thing to look at, but it seems like it generated the most outrage and disgust out of any shooting I can remember, at least in terms of an angry political response. So I'm speculating, of course, but I would imagine that in the aftermath of something like that, government agencies are under pressure to sort of do something when Congress is unable or unwilling to pass any sort of significant either gun control legislation or other form of response to this.
Yeah, I also saw in your article, which is available online, we'll link to it in the video of this when it goes up on our YouTube channel. There's a reference to this program not just helping to limit loss of life, but also limit loss of property. Do you have any idea what they're referencing there?
Unfortunately, the procurement documents that I found didn't elaborate on that, but that sort of was shocking to me because it's, we're talking about high school kids. I mean, that doesn't even factor into my mind. I doubt it would into parents or, hardly anyone unless you're maybe like the Terminator looking around at through some kind of headset looking at, things purely rationally. I can't imagine even considering that. So I don't know. That was really shocking to me to find it. Unfortunately, they didn't really clarify what they meant by that.
Yeah. Now, this might be outside of the bounds of the research that you've done, but I do wonder if some of the sort of career bureaucrats at the DHS, some of which I imagine are probably responsible, rational people, if they wanted to do more to actually address some of the root causes of these sorts of shootings or do something that steps into the process a little bit before we're in the middle of the shooting, is there any fear that the fact that Donald Trump and most of the people he has surrounding him are so obviously pro-gun, they have no interest whatsoever in doing anything to limit it. Can that sort of like guiding ideology of the government in any way hamper what departments like the DHS actually do in practice to deal with these situations?
It's a very interesting question. And I have a number of sources in the Department of Homeland Security that have told me that, you know, while there are career bureaucrats that have been there from various administrations, I know one that left under, he had been there during Obama and during Bush, and he was by no means a partisan, and Trump was just, off the spectrum. And you know, Obama wasn't great on deportations either, and of course, neither was Bush. So, this person isn't some sort of, far left figure. It was just, he was so disgusted with the direction things were going with the, family separation policy and things like that, that he felt compelled to leave. But to answer your question, that's a major concern of a number of people I've spoken to in DHS, that the organization is being politicized, that they're pushing out people that are either willing or enthusiastic to, carry out or trumpet the policies that Trump has passed. And the concern at that point is when you have these political appointments that are being put in there, they tend not to have the technical experience that you need to have, because it's not just with Department of Homeland Security, they're not just doing, the deportations. They also, handle drug gang stuff. And, you've got FEMA, and these are things that, there's quite a bit that DHS does that I don't think people would find controversial. But when you have people that are just going to be loyalists, they tend not to be, have much expertise in these kind of things. And it's a very difficult, as we were, talking about before, crisis response, handling long-term investigations, sort of like the FBI does, which is what Homeland Security Investigates does. These are very technical things that take years of experience and education. And so, when you're just trying to find loyalists to stack the place with, you're probably not going to have the best candidates that you would have if you were just considering professional. So, it poses serious problems, and it can politicize the entire thing.
And it seems like this is a story we've seen played out in multiple different departments. I had one more question for you, though. So one of the reasons we're so lucky to have you at TOT Investigates is this sort of investigative reporting that you've done. Very often I see you getting shared very widely, and this story is a great example of that. Did you happen to notice, and I ask this because we're in the middle of this ongoing nationwide tour of the Parkland activists, has there been any response from any of these student activists on the gun issue to this reporting about the dealing with the staunching of blood?
The response was overwhelming. I mean, I've done many stories. I've been a reporter for a few years now, and the kids seemed shocked and horrified, and said, kind of just pleading with adults, like, please do something so that this isn't our only line of defense. Is literally, having to plug up my friend as like geysers of blood are gushing out. They just seemed completely disgusted, and frankly, really scared, and hoping that someone. That someone would help them, because they don't have, they literally can't vote. Children, the legal system we have, children just don't have the same rights that adults have. So, they're really at adults' mercy. And, I commend them for the political engagement that they've taken part in, but it's limited what they can do. So they just seemed really astonished and worried that this is the direction things are going.
Yeah, well, I share that worry. Ken, thank you so much for joining us once again on The Damage Report.
Hey, thanks a lot for having me.
Great work. Thank you so much for watching this video from The Damage Report. Please don't forget to like the video and also to subscribe to the channel so that you get notified as soon as new videos become available. To hear even more about both this topic and other issues not being covered nearly enough by the mainstream media, you're gonna wanna tune in every morning to our full hour-long show. That's at 12 p.m. Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific, available on the TYT Network channel on YouTube TV.